Welcome to Life, Lessons, and Laughter with your host, Glenn Ambrose.
Hello! Welcome to Laughter. Welcome to the podcast. We are back with part two with Gladys Ellen. Wonderful.
Yay.
Yes.
What a treat.
It is. It is our treat. And we're having some fun, which is always good. Gladys, please give us a little recap of what our subject is that we started in session one.
Well, I think we're diving more into the idea of finding balance with your soul mission and spiritual journey. Soul mission, once again, is everything that you do for others. Spiritual journey is what you're doing for yourself. Learning to recognize the warning signs and heeding the advice when we get it to be able to take care of ourselves.
Yes, that was perfect. That was a little scary. That made me feel a little uncomfortable about my own capabilities. That was so perfect.
Yeah, no.
Thank you very much.
Like a podcast? We're dumping him.
Maybe that's in the foresight, right?
Yeah. So I had a question.
Sure.
When you talked about soul mission, yeah, in the beginning of the last episode, mm-hmm, you mentioned several different characteristics of people, caregivers,
healers,
earth
angels, light workers. Yes.
Yeah. What are those? What are the difference?
So they
I have no
are,
idea what you're talking
yep,
about.
Yep. So I think of them, there is a gentleman who's written books about this concept, and I have no clue his name. Maybe we can find out and write it in, so I'm not talking about somebody else's work, but this is not my own.
So what he does is
he describes what I call caregivers, healers, earth angels, light workers. Caregivers are like the nurses, the social workers. Healers, obviously, are the people who are doing energy work, you know, that are helping people, maybe psychotherapists, psychiatrists, energy workers. Light workers are the people who are bringing light to the planet, who are consciously helping people wake up. I believe Oprah is an example of a light worker. And earth angels, the people who are here to help the earth. You know, look at Steve Irwin, who is coming here to help with the planets and the planet with the animals. And, you know, we have these people that are walking this planet on this mission. And I find that they're like the white blood cells of the body. So there are so many people who are the red blood cells. They get up, they go to work, you know, they, you know, take care of their children. They're living their lives, which is nothing wrong with that. That's what their life is. That's what they were born into. That was the path that they chose. Then there are these other people who don't think like everybody else, who will challenge the system, who will wake people up. I call them like the white blood cells. They're like the fighters. They don't think like everybody else. So sometimes we kind of look at ourselves as like the misfits, the ones that don't fit in. We're the ones, well, there's a lot of us who don't fit in, but, and then we struggle with, well, why can't I just live my life this way? And why can't it just happen for me this way? Well, that's not the life that we chose. We chose to see a problem and go in and fix it. We chose to, you know, shed the light on the world, to be able to share our knowledge and wisdom through our growth process, through our, you know, old souls and the knowledge that we have. And so that's how I can describe the differences in, you know, and don't get me wrong, there are many people now who are awakening to these gifts within. They're now becoming more aware of, okay, I've gone through this trauma and I can give back in some way. And they're kind of opening themselves up. But the caregivers, healers, earth angels, light workers are the ones who never fit in, who always did things their own way, who challenged the indigos, the, you know, the crystal children, the rainbow children. You know, they're the ones that, you know, what society would call different. I certainly don't think there's anything different about me. I'm, you know, I love to go out and have a good time with my friends, but there's this other part of me that I'm for the underdog and I want people to live a healthy, happy life, you know? So I realize that my life isn't traditional. I tried the corporate world to work in the law firm and it was a very good job, but it just wasn't for me. So I had to realize that, all right, where do I fit in?
Right. That was another question that I wanted to ask last time. What did your family and friends think when you switched from corporate real estate lawyer to holistic health? I don't want to get your title wrong.
Mm-hmm. Holistic health and practitioner and spiritual advisor.
There we go.
Well, You know, I've always been headstrong and independent. So I think they all realized there was going to be no stopping me. That I don't do things brashly. I do really think about it's methodical how I do things and how I approach things. And I have my family loves me very much. So it was like, all right, we'll support you. You know, my mom didn't understand it. She's like, oh, she can do that. I can't. Right. She's learning that she can certainly, you know, call in this energy. But they were supportive, you know, for the most part. You know, it took some time for some people to understand. I think they might have thought it was a thing and just something like, oh, she has this awakening and this is a phase she's going through. But then when I started to do, you know, grow the business and started to put myself out there more and invest more time and energy into it, and it started to grow. And, you know, I speak for spiritualist churches. I go into companies. I do guided meditations in companies. I teach about angels and spiritual classes for organizations. I go into, there's a college that I'll be going into to be able to talk to the kids who are under pressure with stress and being in school and having to get good grades. So there's so many things that this world offers. And I think I've helped them by putting myself out there. But there really wasn't a lot of resistance. I did have a relationship that it took some time. You know, he did respect it. He didn't understand it, but it was the place that he was in. But I think he learned a lot from my path and my experience through it. So even though we're not together anymore, I believe he did learn a lot from it. But again, free will, you choose how to take it either way.
Yeah.
So, but you know, I believe, you know, God's got my back, and the people who are supposed to be in my life are in my life. And the people who weren't going to be healthy or were toxic have been pushed out. Not that I call my friends up and say, hey, your energy no longer serves me. I can't, you know, hang out with right. you anymore. It's a natural progress. The more good I feel, the more happy I am, the less those toxic people can hold in that vibration. Yeah. So I usually say with people, you know, as you're on this soul mission and spiritual journey, don't worry about the toxic people and the negative people in your life. You know, live your life, get out, get away from them when you can, and go enjoy your life, live happily. And what happens is your vibration raises up, you feel good, and those people naturally won't fit in that bubble anymore. Because, or if they are supposed to, they'll start to change their own lives. They'll start to get better in that way. They'll start to make changes because, again, your energy now is fueling that for them to saying, you know what? I want to feel like that. And if she can do that, I can do that. And that's that part of being able to empower people through your work and what you're doing. It doesn't matter what you're doing. You know, it could be a lawyer, a doctor, a hairstylist. If you're loving what you're doing, that vibration or that energy is going to raise up. And those people who aren't going to fit is going to naturally be pushed out of your life. So you have to be okay with whatever happens next. That's the agreement you have to make with the universe. Am I okay with these changes? And that's that part of that spiritual awakening, quote unquote, that they say, that conscious living is your life will change. It will never be the same. I mean, there's lots of beauty and gifts and joy, and I would not trade this life for anything, but I've had to let go of a lot of really difficult things. I've had to make some changes and really look at the raw part of me and saying, all right, I've got some issues here that I've got to work on, and it's going to stink to really sit with it and reach out and expose these vulnerabilities to people so that they can help me. But again, I know that God's got my back and he's going to send the right people in my life. You know, so anybody who says having a spiritual awakening is easy has never had a spiritual awakening, you know, because the process is painful. It's the birthing process. You know, they call it dark night of the soul, or they call it the darkness. You know, this is where you kind of go into yourself, you know, to really question yourself and the planet and what is real and what's not real. You know, it's kind of like a seed. You know, we can put a seed on the table and it would stay there forever. The second you bury it in the darkness, in the ground, what happens? It starts to pull from all the nutrients that are in that darkness and starts to grow and flourish, right? So nobody wants to go in the darkness, but again, that's where you're going to be nourished. That's where you're going to be in this container and start to grow. And then eventually you'll poke out and you'll be at a beautiful, I don't know, fruit tree or plant or something with beautiful flowers. But that's the process. And so many people, because they've been forced to look at their spiritual journey, because things have been let go in their lives, unhealthy relationships and jobs, because of that, they've been forced to go underground, to go into this darkness, to really pull from, you know, from that energy. So think about, where are the Earth's treasures? underground, right? Diamonds, gold, where is it? In the earth, right? Money is made from paper, you know? I mean, all, you know, what do we do with money? You know, we hide it in the darkness, right? What do we do with our treasures? We put them in safes and safety deposit boxes. We're putting our treasures in the darkness. Well, we do that when we're going through these challenges and changes. We go into the darkness, but we're so afraid of it because it is scary and we can't see in front of us. And this is where we have to use that universal energy of love to guide us through it. You know, send me the people in my life that are going to help me. Send me the people that, you know, can help me shift this. And this is this spiritual journey process that I feel like we've been going through. And again, now coming out of it with these awarenesses, the challenge is, how do I balance that, right? Soul mission, spiritual journey. Because
and coming out of it too, I think that's a big point, because I thought that the seed was a great analogy. Mm-hmm. And that's like, I think of it as pain pushes us until pleasure pulls us. So it's that, you know, generally we do start waking up when we are in the dark and we're going through difficult times. And it's not easy. Then once we do break through, then we are in the light. Mm-hmm. And we can continue growing in that light.
For the time being, until we go into the birthing canal again.
Maybe. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
It's like I think
resistance causes
a lot
of that.
The more we want, the more things need to shift and change.
Right.
So we have to be okay with, you know, in 2007, when I started my business, my mantra was learning how to be comfortable, uncomfortable. Because the second you step outside of that box, you'll no longer be comfortable. So everything I do, even though it appears I'm comfortable, it's not comfortable. There's worries and there's fears and there's like, oh my God, what am I going to do? And how am I paying my bills? And I'm like, oh yeah, that's right. I'm 8 years into this and I'm perfectly fine. You know, I can do this.
And
right?
if you resist that uncomfortability, that to me really makes it more difficult and darker. Mm-hmm. Whereas if, yes, it is uncomfortable.
You've got to have a vision for where you want
to
be.
And learn to stand in that. Mm-hmm. And be like, okay, yes, this is uncomfortable, but I'm okay being uncomfortable.
Yes.
The better you get at that, the less
easier
dark
these changes are
going to
be.
The easier it's going to be. So you don't get stuck in that darkness for so long.
Well, in a way, I think that's staying in the darkness long enough to grow out of it.
Yes, absolutely.
Like, I think that what you're saying is, if you're resisting it, it's like if a seed was trying to dig itself out.
Yes.
Instead of staying there.
Right. The darkness can, the darkness, so you do need to go into the darkness. It's just a matter of whether you perceive it as just uncomfortable and you can handle it, or if you resist against it.
Yes.
If you resist against it, it's really crappy.
It slows the process. And then you have to go back and do it again. And that's where we get on that hamster wheel of these things. Oh, here I am with the money stuff again. Here I am with the health stuff again. Here I am with the family stuff again. Why is this happening over and over again? Because we don't give ourselves the time enough to grow. We're not going to plant a seed and then we'll wake up the next morning and dump the pot. Oh, it's not going to grow. We have to give it time. We've got to nurture it. We've got to, you know, give it sunlight. We've got to water it, right? So these are those things that we've got to lean on our support system at that time to nurture us while we're in that space. But really, the spiritual journey, nobody can do it for us. We're the only ones that can get through this stuff. You know, you're the only one that can quit smoking or stop drinking or give up the sugar or get out of debt. You're the only one that can do that by actions. But again, you can have people that can help you, right?
Right.
Then when you're getting out of it, it's almost like, all right, well, how do I not go back into that? It's like finding the balance between soul mission, spiritual journey, because again, we're here to serve, right? We're here to take care of. So we don't want to get to the point where I've given myself to everybody and nobody's there for me and I don't want to help anybody anymore, because that's not going to serve us either, right? One of the examples I have is in my business is, when I'm not taking care of myself and I have my room is a mess, so I've got emails that are piling up, or I've got things I need to do for myself, I need to rest and sleep. What happens is my business starts to slow down. The phone calls stop coming in, the emails stop, the phone stops ringing. And of course, that's a trigger for me. I'm like, hey, wait a minute, what's going on here? What's changing? And at that point, it's almost like your soul mission gets out too far. And then you start to drag yourself along. So the second I turn around and say, okay, the universe is giving me an open slot here. What do I need? What loose ends do I need to tie up for myself? Do I need to get my laundry done? Do I need to make sure I'm eating healthy and getting exercise? Do I need to clean out my desktop or, you know, my mail or something? The second I turn that focus on myself and start to do those things, the phone calls start, the emails start coming in, you know, and the requests start coming up again. So for me, I figured out that's my trigger. So I'm like, all right, universe, show me when I'm not taking care of myself through that. And I promise that the second I realize that, I'm going to stop, trust that it will pick back up again, it will get going again, and I'll take care of myself. I'll take that time out. And sometimes it's months that people have to do it. Sometimes it's weeks. Sometimes it's a day that they have to look at themselves. So by being consciously aware, you're learning to live and walk soul mission, spiritual journey. And that does not mean every time you do something for somebody else, you have to do something for yourself. But what it means is being aware of how much you're expending, being aware of yourself, your body. I'm depleted and tired. I'm irritable. I'm feeling angry and resentful. Mm. Well, that certainly means your energy is depleted and you need to take a break, whether it's a mental health day, you know, whether it's a walk around, you know, outside for some fresh air, something that fills you up. That's spiritual journey stuff. The second you do that, everything else opens back up again.
And you can't give what you don't have.
Exactly.
You know, so that's, and that's one of the I don't know, I'll call it a hook that I try to grab people's attention with, that are, because generally the people that, I'm guessing that you've noticed this. Mm-hmm. I've noticed it. The people who I work with are very caring, loving yes. people.
Yeah, of course.
Well, because that's who you're needs gonna, the help.
Yes.
That, you know, so that's who comes. So, you know, when you're working with a lot of loving, caring people, they want to give of themselves, mm-hmm. you know. And I mean, the typical example is the mother always doing everything for their
yes.
kids.
Yep.
So it's, yes, do everything for them. Do everything. Well, you're only giving them 50% of yourself
yes.
or 25% of yourself because you're so burned out that mm-hmm. you don't have 100% of yourself to give them.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it's if mm-hmm. you want to give 100% to your kids, you have to have 100%
yes.
to give.
Within.
So,
it's like,
yeah.
You know, I teach to give from the overflow. When I teach my energy training classes, I teach them to fill yourself up first and give from the overflow. If you have time and not money, give your time. If you have money and not time, give your money. If you don't have money or time, don't give money or time.
Right.
Fill yourself up, right? Fill your bank up. So when, you know, they say at the register, oh, do you want to give a dollar to this? Do you want to give to the dollar to that? I think about it and I'm like, do I have this to give an overflow? And I'll say yes or no based on my tank. You know, if somebody says, can you do this for me? Or do you want to do this for me? I stop and think, do I have the time for this? Do I want to do this? Is this going to make me feel good? And then I make that choice because I'm giving from the overflow. If I'm thinking, oh gosh, this is just another thing that I'm worried about. I know I'm empty and I have to take a break. And you know, I went to Six Flags this summer with a friend of mine and we rode roller coasters all day. It was our way to fill ourselves up. So when I was in the office for the next 2 weeks, just working and being busy, I wasn't resentful, even though I love what I do. I wasn't resentful thinking I don't have any time for myself because I took that time to fill myself up. And I'll tell you, the roller coasters filled me up for a long time. That was a good time. But again, it's like being conscious of how you're feeling. And that's that part of that self-love, self-care in a way where you've got to be aware of how you're feeling. You got to know yourself. If you don't know when you're tired and depleted, until it's too late, you got to heed those warnings. If you don't know you're full because you're eating so fast, right? How are you going to know? So there's all these experiences that are teaching you how to know yourself better, to be able to recognize the warning signs, to be able to recognize when. And that's kind of what we're doing as we move into 2016. You know, we've been taking these actions all year, you know, and I've kind of described this year, 2015, as kind of been like, if you've ever traveled down the East Coast, it's like being stuck in Virginia traffic. Virginia traffic is a mess. So you hear me here. So this is where we've been. So we have, when we came into this life, planned this trip to Disney. And we were going to drive there from New England. And we all got in the car and we've been driving along and it's been fun. You get through Baltimore, you know, oh yeah, it's a good time. Then you get to Virginia and you come to a screeching halt. what happens when you're sitting in that traffic, you start to get irritable. You're starting to see the GPS click up. Oh, now I'm not going to get there till this hour, this hour, this hour, this hour. Now you're getting more antsy. You lose sight of Disney. You know, you've planned this beautiful trip. You know where you're going to stay. You know what parks you're going to go to, what rides you're going to ride. You start to lose that vision when you're stuck in traffic, especially Virginia traffic, right? This year for 2015, this is where we've been. We've been stuck in this traffic. We know we're going to get through it, but we've had to ask ourselves, is there actions that I can take to make this more comfortable? What can I do? Can I pop in some music I haven't heard from a long time? Can I play games with the people that are in my car? Maybe I can make a phone call. You know, maybe I can make light of it. Or am I going to not let anybody in if I'm going to like flip everybody off and just be pissed off the whole time? Either way, we're still going to be stuck in traffic. So we have a choice on how we move through it. So 2015 has been us slowly moving through this traffic. We can see we're getting to the end of it because we're making progress, but it's still there, right? So I see 2016 is us getting through that traffic and starting to move a little bit. But don't forget, we still have to go North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, and Florida, right? To kind of get to where we are. So we're still on this journey. So I believe 2016 is us enjoying the place that we're in, moving along. We're still going to have to make pit stops. We're going to have to stop to fuel up. We're still going to have to stop to get something to eat. You know, we're still going to maybe get a flat tire on the way. We're still going to be in that place, but we're going to be able to ride a little bit easier. We're not going to be in that intense traffic that goes on for eight lanes for miles and miles. You know, this is what 2015 has been. It's like we've had to stop and take action. We've had to go through the process and take the steps, you know, and really ask myself, like, or ask yourself is, you know, how am I choosing to move through this? Either way, you're going to be there. So, you know, 2016 for me seems more positive and uplifting. We're coming through lots of experiences where the universe, well, the planet needs light. How can we teach people to live in joy and happiness when we ourselves can't even do it? So what we're doing by going through all this experience ourselves is learning to move through it joyfully, happy, being abundant. So now when, because there are masses of people who haven't even started this journey yet, you know, and so they need inspiration. They need light to say, okay, you know, you can do this, keep going. So 2016 is us for really to live in the joy, to be able to be grateful for what we have, enjoy the fruit of our abundance, moving into the land of milk and honey. That's what 2016 is. All right, these are the lessons I've learned. And now, you know, I feel like I've got money now. You know, the debt is slowly going down. You know, I have the positive people around me, healthy family. I'm really liking my job. We can have it all. And this is that land that we're moving into because we're not in the place where we'll go back to fix, change, save, and make better for people anymore. And that's what caregivers did. They sunk themselves to fix things for people, save them, change them, make them better.
Absolutely. Like 2015. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of what I've seen, because it seems like 2015, in a lot of ways, people have made a fair amount of ground. Like they've finally taken action in areas that they've wanted to, and their lives are moving forward.
Well, they haven't had a choice.
Right, they haven't had a choice. But it seems like, before 2015, they weren't quite able to. 2015, they were able to, and I believe we even talked about it before 2015 started, that 2015 was going to be action and we're going to be doing things, and we did.
In baby steps, too.
Right, it's been baby steps, and I think the reason it's been baby steps is because there's such a large growing edge to that. Mm-hmm. Like, yes, we are taking action. Yes, our lives are expanding. We are going in the right direction. We are headed to Florida, which I love.
Mm-hmm.
I love Florida. Anyway, we are going there, but since this is our first year really taking the action and really going, that it is a little bit backed up, and we are, you know, even though we are doing what we're supposed to and taking the action, it's a little choppy. Mm-hmm. And
we have to ask ourselves on our spiritual journey, how do I choose to move through this? Do I want to be pissed off and angry?
Right.
And or do I want to just embrace it? Because either way, because you think about law of attraction, when you get to Florida, if you fought it the whole way, we already know that Disney's not going to be that fun, that you're going to have problems, they're not going to have the right room, they're going to have all these hiccups and bumps, right? Or if you've enjoyed the process, you know that when you get there, you're going to have an incredible time. The universe is going to say, you know what, your energy is great, and we're going to show you the best time ever. So again, you might as well do it now, right, to be able to enjoy Disney or that land of milk and honey or wherever we are, to be able to enjoy where we are. Like, I can truly appreciate this, and I'm really happy where I am. I'm consciously living and making choices based on what it is that I want, and because of that, I'm able to help others, which is the perfect balance of soul mission and spiritual journey.
Yeah, there's no happy destination at the end of an unhappy road.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we have to be happy going there, mm-hmm. you know, because it's, I mean, like you said, once we get to Disney, it's going to be like, we're going to be bent, man. Yeah. If we're bent all the way there, mm-hmm. it's going to take a while to try to shake that off mm-hmm. and actually enjoy yourself mm-hmm. once you get there. But if you're, you know, at peace with the destination,
mm-hmm.
that's, you know, be happy on the journey.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there
realistically
isn't,
happy.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean we always have to be happy for this to work. It's just being aware of it, moving through. All right, I'm not too happy right now. I don't really like this experience, but I know it's going to get better. I know there's going to be a shift in this. I know I'm moving towards the light, you know,
right. And that's
whatever
what our acceptance can give us. I mean, if we're sitting there fighting, you know, the traffic is a perfect example. If mm-hmm. we're fighting the traffic and we're resisting it, mm-hmm. that
it spends so much energy.
Yeah, and it just wrecks the trip.
Mm-hmm.
And it's, you know, it doesn't make anything better
mm-hmm.
if we are resisting it.
Mm-hmm.
That's, you know, like it's, you're right. We don't have to be, I think sometimes people like will hang on to their bitterness because
mm-hmm.
they think that's something that causes transition.
Mm-hmm.
Like they'll be like, well, no, if I say that the traffic isn't bothering me, well, then I'll stay in it forever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, no, you're going to get through it mm-hmm. regardless, whether
mm-hmm.
whether you say you're unhappy or whether you say you're happy,
mm-hmm.
you're going to get through it.
Mm-hmm.
So which way do you want to
yeah.
do it?
And the key thing is they have to take action to do that.
Right.
So you have to pop in the music you like. You have to make the phone call. You have to play the games. It's all action. I say you can wish and hope and dream and pray forever, or you can hold a vision and go do something about it. Whether it's, you know, I ran a 5K for the first time this year. I've been wanting to do it forever. I just shaved a minute and a half off my time. You know, I'm still working towards that goal. I'm the only one who had to get my, you know, tuchus out there on the course and
hey,
start running.
Hey, watch the language with the tuchus.
And start running, right? Nobody else could do it for me. But this is what people are learning. Like, you know, there's that action in it.
Right.
And people now being fueled by their spiritual journey to saying, hey, I want this badly. And I want to do this. And there's so many inspirational stories out there that are teaching people that. There's so much accessibility to the world, you know, through these outlets that we have that are connecting us to being able to find the resources and the tools that are going to be able to help us get where we want to be, whether it's just to get out and go for a walk, or whether it's to make a certain amount of money, or whether it's to, you know, have a child, or, you know,
golf more
or do better with that. You've got to make that commitment, you know what I mean, to saying, all right, I want to do this, and I'm willing to move through every option to get myself there.
To act yourself into better thinking,
yes.
instead of thinking yourself into better
yes.
action.
You got it.
Wow.
I think I heard that somewhere.
Yeah,
oh, really? Because I was going to say, we got to trademark that one.
Yeah, I probably said that about five times on this one.
No. I mean, I don't know. You've said it to me like 7,000 times.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I haven't heard
I'm
it.
Sure,
so say
it
again.
Podcast.
So you need to act yourself into better thinking. You can't think yourself into better acting.
I love that. That's the whole thing in a nutshell.
That's it. Thank you. Good night.
Yeah, right.
So
I think we got like 3.5 more minutes or so to
nice.
Fill. So,
well, yeah. So
let's talk about movies.
So,
how would you recap that?
So my big message is the planet needs more light. The planet needs more people who are living happily, who are really grateful for where they are, sharing, paying forward, giving back. The only way to do that is to work on your spiritual journey and help yourself feeling better. to fill yourself with that light instead of feeling like when this person's better, then I'll be better. When I do save this person, or when I fix this, or I change this and make this better, because there will always be something else to fix, change, save, and make better. The second you unplug from that codependency and look within, all right, God, what do I need to do for myself? You fill yourself up. If I walked in here and I was a mess and I'm this inspirational speaker and I go out and I talk to people and motivate them, if I was dragging myself in here and my life was a mess, you'd be like, if this isn't working for her, how is it going to work for me? Right?
Right.
So we need to be the example, and we need to live and show that God is good, that we can live abundantly and happy and joyfully in going through these trials and tribulations. We can still be that because we need to be the example for the masses who haven't even scratched the surface yet. They need to be able to see a vision. Like, you know, again, like you said, you look to people, all right, who's done the 5K and who's run and who's ran this business and who's done this? You look to those people, the Oprahs and the Tony Robbins, because they've done it, right? That's us for them now. We're now moving through it to do it, to shed that light and hold that space in a way where we can say, this is so much fun and I love my life and I'm sharing that with so many others.
And things get better one person at a time.
It's true.
And it's, you know, that's what I love about it. It's win-win. You know, it's, we look around at the world and we can point the finger and say, there's problems. Oh, I wish things were better. How can I do it? Well, you know, like Gandhi said, be the change you wish to see in the world. So
action.
You start with yourself. If you are happier just by you being happier,
with yourself, who you are,
finding out who you are, connecting with it, being more of yourself. As you do that, the universe gets better, the world gets better.
Saying, "Hey,
and
this
because
is me."
Then once you do that, you can give from the overflow.
Yes.
And
wow. Got it.
If you would like help doing that, Gladys, how can people get a hold of you?
They can find me on my website, gladysellen.com. I've got my online booking, my classes, the events, the things I'll be doing, the message, the group readings and places where I'll be is on my website. I have an office located in Gold Plaza on Warwick Avenue. And I am, like I said, loving life. So if I can help you in any way, I'm here.
Glad.
And you can also come see Gladys. Well, will this air before?
So
December 14th.
Yeah.
So you can see her here at the Glenn Ambrose Life Enhancement
Center. Yeah, I think
this
will actually be December 13th.
Perfect. Well,
so come see her tomorrow at my place. And you can get more information on that on my website at life-enhancement-services. So thanks for listening, everybody. Gladys, thank you for being my first guest and
my
doing such
pleasure.
A wonderful job.
Good. I'm glad. Thanks for having me.
My pleasure. It was fun. We'll have to do this again. I like the guest thing. So keep listening, everybody, and we'll talk at you soon.
Bye.
This podcast is presented by New Shore Productions. Executive producers Glenn Ambrose, Benjamin Barber, and David DeAngelis.